So welcome here on stage. Bonsoir, Taziden and Claude.
Hi.
The next talk is on building a better internet. It all started, I think, 2 years ago at the 30C3 when these two guys were here inviting us to build our own ISP. And this year, they want to invite us to build something like a better internet, which is a small box, I think, they have brought with them. Yeah, that prevents your ISP from snooping on your traffic and enables you to circumvent things like carrier grade net and all of these oddities. Stage is yours.
Thanks. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. So we are going to talk to you about the Internet Cube, which is this little box you can see here. Maybe you have heard already about this project with the French name, La Brique Internet. But today, we're going to stick with the Internet Cube. So let's start with some facts.
Nubius, when today we have an internet made of big silos. And this is really something we are uncomfortable with and really something we need to change. We give information to a lot of companies, a lot of entities, governments, and stuff that are having this power to influence us through this. So yeah, it is to say that we have this princess freedom, we can say that, yeah, being held by, I don't know, some evilish, I don't know, Ganondorf? Yeah, Ganondorf. Yeah, like, you know, like, yeah, Google, Amazon, Netflix, Apple, Microsoft, Dropbox. Nasty one. On-click, doubleclick.google.cobase.com or something like this. And Reddit, obviously, and Facebook. That's for sure. Fact number two, maybe.
Yeah. Fact number two, internet needs diversity. Like, as I said, internet is, like today, as Claude said, the information is centered in silos, but not only the personal information, but also the public information. And we can ask today, what is your freedom if the only information you get is from the top 100 websites? So that's a major problem. We need more networks. We need more websites, we need more information, more sources, more diversity, and obviously we need more networks.
Yeah. Thankfully, we have this hypertext link to the rescue of the princess here. And well, he seems like a bit sad with it, only his shield and stuff. So he has to find this artifact to get into this old cave with old men in the cave and find, I don't know, maybe something. Maybe an internet cube. Yeah. Okay. This was a bit tough on it, but this is, yeah, we have one here. And without further ado, we'll make a quick demo so that you have an idea of how it works.
We have one here connected on the podium.
Yeah, we just plugged in just before the conference, so that we ensure that it has boots at some point. But
so let's see what's on there.
Yeah, you just have to type my domain name, a very common one. Yeah, it works. So this is where it works, but we don't really see it. So it's on the device like this. And yeah, I just have my awesome website on it.
Let's
and I
see
can
what it is.
I can just yeah, have my emails I mean receive my emails here, I guess. I hope. So you can actually send me emails on yeah, it is.
Sorry, Let's Encrypt is not yet included, but
I have to apologize.
We're working on
yeah,
it.
Of course. It is self-signed certificates.
It's in
but
French.
Proper ciphers and stuff. Don't worry. yeah. Okay.
You really accepted permanently? Oh, that's bad.
I did. Oh, fuck. Yeah. So it is running on the 4G connection here because I don't know, the CCC network is kind of spoofing things sometimes. And yes, I will try to receive my emails here. Yeah, don't move too much. He's working here. Yeah, please. Please, 4G. Oh, that's something.
Sorry, the packets are going through Europe and so stuff like that, through Belgium, outside countries, France also, of course.
Yeah, that's because HTTPS is slowing up connections, right? No? Oh. Yeah, maybe we won't have emails, but I still have my Opsom website on it. Oh, yes, it works. Sorry about that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you remember the password? Can you?
Yeah, I did. Something very strong. Yeah. Do you have something funny to say?
No. Not after the talk I gave yesterday, yeah. No, sorry.
Yeah.
So, how are you today? You're doing great?
Maybe we can explain that. Yeah, we just plugged it in so far. We even put this 4G phone in USB directly on the connected through USB to the cube, and it worked. It recognized a device, an internet device on the USB device, and automatically connected it to internet. So this is kind of plug and play thing.
Actually,
play being slow.
Maybe we can explain that we switched to the 3G connection because we had issues during the preparation with the networks. Here at the Congress, some people were trying to
spoofing DNS
and so on.
Or SSL certificates. It was what an idea.
So let's wait a little bit and
come on.
But it was working earlier.
Of course it was working before. Yeah. Okay, maybe what we can say about this is, don't try this at home. Of course, it's dangerous. Receiving emails, actual emails, on a 3G connected device can be tricky at some point.
Okay, maybe we can.
Yeah, we can go further and just get back to it after it. So the question is how does it actually works?
When it works.
Does it work?
So how does it work?
Yeah.
That's the interesting part. This is a little box, a little cube, and what is interesting with this is that it's the union of three major essential parts, three basic elements that combine together give something very interesting. And the first part is open hardware. We need to do this to achieve what we are describing. We need to have an open hardware, hardware that is cheap, low voltage, that is hackable, with specifications online. And so far, the best match we had is Olimex ARM board. But open hardware is just one element, and you need to have free software running on top of this open hardware. And that's something Claude has been working on for a long time now.
For like 3 years, we worked on a software called Why in a Host, which is basically a Debian-based distribution that aims to facilitate or to ease the installation and the management, the handling of services on the server, using the user creation management, the backup creation, the domain creation, the extension of the server capabilities with applications and stuff. So that's about it regarding the software part. You can find further information on the website whereyouknowhost.org. And yes, we had those two components, so a cool hardware, open, and Olimex is quite a cool manufacturer, and we had this software which works on that board. But we needed something in order to solve this issue, this network issue that obviously is a pain in the ass when you are trying to self-host, to host yourself. It's like, how can I make my server open on the internet? And that's how the third component comes out. Is yes, we need actually. We chose to add to this a VPN connection and to a trustworthy provider.
Yeah, 2 years ago, I was here at the Congress giving a talk about inviting you to build your own ISPs, and when you are running such ISPs, you should communicate and help each other in order for the networks to grow and these networks to happen, to have them everywhere, actually. So we met with Freifunk and so on. That was really great. And so we, at the time, presented a tool called db.ffdn.org. And you can find on this site a whole bunch of providers, internet access providers, non-profit ones, that are enabling us with this cube to provide VPN access with public endpoints, which means you can have your data, your personal data, or your public data accessible through the internet, through a trusted connection, going through a friendly ISP. And that's something that is not possible with the most of the commercial ISPs that are blocking the port 25, that are doing silly stuff, that are doing discrimination on the network. And they really don't want us to do self-hosting. So yeah, that's the third element that I've seen missing in most of the projects about this kind of matter. It's how do you can trust the hardware, you can work on the hardware, you can work on the software, but the missing link is always, I think, the third one. It's about the connection to the internet. Yeah. And so combined together, these three elements give what we think is kind of a holy trinity, like,
yeah.
And this makes the internet cube.
Those three parts are very legit in the sense that, yeah, it now comes as a plug and play device, something really plug and play, even though it is a bit slow sometimes, right? But
depends on the network. So.
Yeah, depends on the network. But yeah, this question of having a friendly ISP is really complicated to solve, and self-hosting is becoming really complicated. Now, having this three parts really makes it makes the cube plug and play. And the cool part is, adding a Wi-Fi antenna on it, and you have actually this neutral network broadcasted through all your house, or every place you go. You have this Wi-Fi. We have one, though. We have a non-discriminant network being broadcasted as of now. No, that's fine. Yeah. They all say they have Wi-Fi.
It's overrated.
So we have also, yes, this possibility is to broadcast a neutral network at home, and just by connecting to it, your commercial, non-trustworthy ISP is not able to read what you're doing of your connection anymore. So there is, those very two parts, the having a neutral network at home and having a personal server working right away. So that makes sense.
That's the very interesting stuff. Interesting thing about all this is that you have two major parts, like connecting to the cube and your data from everywhere on the internet, and also at your home or wherever you are, you can connect to the internet through a trusted channel. And of course, this is what we came up with, but I think there are many others things we can do. But maybe you're wondering how do you get one, a working one, of course.
That's a good question. Yeah.
That's an interesting question. And so it's easy for French people or Belgian to have one because there are non-profit local ISPs providing these cubes nearby. But as I said, the local part is very important. So what you should do is maybe think about building your own ISP, providing VPN access such as we do. And also all the parts, all the documentation of the software and so on is online. And we really invite people to build their own. If you have questions about building your own ISP and providing public IPs to friends and to people around you, ask us, we can help you. It's really what we want to do, is really to have more networks and have more projects like this.
A thing that we often miss here is that it is not as difficult as we think to build an actual VPN provider. We've done it a lot in France. We've done I don't know how many members there are in the federation as well.
In the federation, we have a federation of non-profit internet access providers, and I think 2 years ago we were like 21, and now we have 28 organizations.
Yeah, like 28 non-profit organizations made by just passionate over friends. So we have knowledge of how you can build one, and if you want to do so, just. We have gathered enough knowledge to help you bootstrap something.
One thing is that before the Internet Cube project came up, we were not so much interested in building VPN service. It really came up like this with people from the YUNOS project, with the Olimex hardware we discovered, and with the people involved in the non-profit ISPs. And this very combination gives something that I think is very, very cool and very inspiring. But there are many things to do with it, and many hacks to invent or things to...
Yeah, of course, this hardware is kind of like a Raspberry Pi, so it has potentially... It has a lot of potential. You can do domotic with it. You can maybe have. We've made pirate boxes quite often. Maybe if you went to camp, you probably have seen me
going
around
with
a pink hat and this actually on my head because I was sharing. I was sharing documents.
And you also did it in Tunisia.
Box. Yeah, in Tunisia too. Well, we did it quite a few times. The thing is, you can build pirate box. You can, as a router, a Wi-Fi router, you can imagine having some kind of Tor gateway, maybe one day, like routing all the traffic instead of VPN, routing it through Tor. This is something we can imagine with that kind of.
We've seen people using it as a way to stream radio from a place.
Yeah, streaming device.
One also interesting thing is that there is a battery plug, so you can just really have it on your backpack. You can recharge it with a solar panel as it's low voltage, and it's really something interesting. And we came up with this by tinkering, and we hope that you will invent other things to do, other creative, stupid, crazy ideas, and that's why we are here, after all.
Yeah, if you want to have more information, though, you have this. This is actually a domain you figured out. It's like internetcube.be, and you have all the information on all the documentation, the mailing list, the IRC, every channel of communication.
Yeah, everything to contact us and to share, exchange, to see what can be improved. Because, for us, it fits in our use cases, but it maybe there are other use cases, like when you are in Tunisia or other countries, there are certainly other things to do with it.
Yeah, anyway, if you want to talk about this, we are NCCC until the end. Probably. And we're glad to answer your questions now. Or we can look at my mails. Okay, question.
Okay. Merci beaucoup, Taziden et Claude. Oui. And do we have questions from the stream viewers or from the audience? That is not the case. So thank you for your talk.
Nope. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bad. One last try.
Oh, we have a question. Yeah, sorry.
Maybe it's too late. Okay, there is a question. Where? Microphone 3.
So thank you for the talk. I don't have much knowledge about your technology so far. So excuse if the question is misplaced, How does it compare to the Tor network in terms of anonymous access and stuff?
Actually, like that? Doesn't compare to the Tor network. You cannot compare them.
No, but in terms of anonymity, it doesn't make you anonymous. It is quite the opposite, actually. The only thing that this box can do is when you connect to it in Wi-Fi in your house, everything that you do of your connection, internet connection, is not readable anymore for your current commercial ISP. Your connection becomes readable for your local friendly local organization that gives you this.
Okay, thank you.
Access.
So you have to worry about your end-to-end connections.
Yeah, as always.
Okay, now I see people lining up. Microphone 2, please.
Yeah. Hi. Can it send emails to Gmail, or is it just within your network? And how does it work? Because they filter home ISPs usually at large providers. You have to have a trusted IP to send email to Gmail and others.
Yes, the ISP, the local ISP, gives you an actual IP address on this box, and this box, can definitely send emails to Gmail and receive emails from Gmail. It is linked to one of your domain, so it is your domain that you are using. Here was very.expert, but you can definitely have a more standard domain. But yes, with that, you can receive emails to your nickname at your domain, and yes, definitely.
And there is a question at microphone 4.
Hi, I'm originally from Tunisia, so I'm a little bit interested in what you did in Tunisia. And during the Tunisian Arab Spring Revolution, it was that mesh network, Sayeda mesh network. Yep. Was it something you did, or?
No, not we. You want to run something, maybe?
No, you.
Sorry. No, we didn't make a mesh network. But this is really something we can imagine with those kind of devices. But this is not what we did in Tunisia. In Tunisia, we just had those devices as pirate boxes to distribute documents, and that's it. And that was
Thank
the
only you.
Okay. I don't see anybody at the mics, yep. Right? Okay, then, thanks again.
Thank you.
Thanks.